We'll call to order the regular meeting of the Elbert Lee City Council for August 28th, 2003. Clerk, please call the roll.
Counselor Christensen.
Here.
Counselor Baker.
Here.
Counselor Holland.
Here.
Counselor Sherry Rasmussen.
Here.
Counselor Robert Rasmussen.
Here.
Counselor Anderson.
Here.
And Mayor Murray.
Here. Would you please rise and join in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to welcome everybody here tonight, both those in person and also those that are online watching us tonight. First order of business, we have a ceremonial item tonight, and I would ask the Safety Director, Jamie Carlson.
Thank you, Mayor. Another exciting night, but I'm going to preface it with I'm looking for many free recruiters from the council, from our staff, and from the community. If you know anybody that is interested in working for the Elbert Lee Police Department, have them contact me or our staff directly, because we'd love to interview them and entertain the opportunity for them to work with us. Right now, we are operationally, I believe, six short. I have one on second phase FTO, and the two this evening are on first phase FTO, and I'm short three bodies. So we're managing, but as we know, we watch the news, it's just tough to get candidates in through the door. What I am very proud of is we must be doing something right here with our department in the city of Elbert Lee, because we sure are attracting local candidates that have been able to see our department and the community firsthand, and they're interested in working for us, so we are excited about that. So with that being said, if this evening, two alumni to the Tiger program here in Elbert Lee, Officer Ben Witham and Officer Dylan Callahan, they're from the area, they're from Freeborn County, and they went to Elbert Lee High School, and we were able to snatch onto them, and we're pretty excited moving forward. Officer Ben Witham started July 31st. He resided in his youth out of Clark's Grove. I believe I've got him moving into the city of Elbert Lee, which is positive. He attended and graduated Elbert Lee High School in 2017, went on to Rochester Community and Technical College, I think for a year of baseball. Still, he was one of our fine hockey goalies in town for many years. He interned with us. 2022, Ben interned with us. We don't do a lot of interns. He interned for extensive hours and got to know our department, which was fantastic. He went on to graduate from Winona State University after attending 2019 to 2023, and most recently completed his law enforcement skills program this year at Alexandria Community College. Officer Dylan Callahan, this is his first day with us, but he's a familiar face here with our department. This is something I'm pretty, I read this in your background, I'm going to share it. Dylan was a safety patrol person in his elementary years, and if this doesn't make you feel old, Jeff Strom and Ted Herman, I think Jeff and Ted Herman presented Dylan as a grade schooler with his certificate for being a safety patrol. So that's pretty neat. For me, what we're starting to see is this doesn't bring you to the end of your career sometime soon. I'm seeing multiple people I've either coached or friends of my kids or people I've known in the community for a long time. So pretty exciting, pretty humbling, but on with Dylan. He graduated Elbert Lee High School in 2021, went on to Riverland Community College. He was a VP of his Criminal Justice Society, completed his skills program this year with Rochester Community and Technical College. Like I mentioned before, he has been a part of our Elbert Lee Police Reserves for since 2022. And most recently, starting January this last year, he was employed with the Maurer County Jail, getting experience as well. So if I can bring both of our newest police officers to the Elbert Lee Police Department up front for their oath of office. Side by side, guys. Yeah.
This way so they can hear you. And I've got a mic on so they can hear me for recording purposes. And I'll ask you both to raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, and please state your name.
I, Dylan Callahan.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
To support the Constitution of the United States.
To support the Constitution of the United States.
And of the state of Minnesota.
And the state of Minnesota.
And to faithfully discharge the duties of police officer.
And to faithfully discharge the duties of police officer.
Within and for the city of Elbert Lee Police Department.
Within and for the city of Elbert Lee Police Department.
In accordance with the laws of Minnesota.
In accordance with the laws of Minnesota.
And of the charter of the city of Albert Lea.
And of the charter of the city of Albert Lea.
In the county of Freeborn.
In the county of Freeborn.
And the state of Minnesota.
And the state of Minnesota.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Thank you. Congratulations.
They've each identified somebody that they've known and trust to pin their badge on with a sharp pen. So. I don't think they've practiced either, so we'll see how this goes. It gets easier with practice. Thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations.
Welcome aboard.
Congratulations.
Welcome.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Well, congratulations and welcome, and thank you to all of our police officers for their service to our community. Thank you very much. JD, anybody on the public forum tonight? No? Okay.
I want to hear more.
Yep. That's about that. All right. Nobody's on the public forum, so we're going to move along to item five, the consent and approval of agenda. Item A is approval of minutes of the August 14th, 2023 regular council meeting. Item B is the approval of minutes of the August 14th, 2023 work session. Item C is license and permits. Item D is a resolution to approve a donation of funds for a new Pelican Breeze dock and donor plaques. Item E is a resolution approving the donation of a memorial bridge along Blazing Star Trail in memory of Terry and Jeremy Brink. Item F is a resolution accepting donations as presented to the City of Albert Lea. Item G is a resolution approving appointment to the Board of Soil and Water Resources Wetland Technical Evaluation Panel, TEP. Item H is a resolution declaring Mexican Independence Day celebration as a community festival. Item I is a resolution approving voter operations technology and election resources, voter, V-O-T-E-R, account agreement. Council.
Your Honor, I move to approve the consent and approval of the agenda.
Councilor Baker makes a motion to approve. Is there a second?
I'll second, Your Honor.
Second by Councilor Anderson. Any questions? Hearing none, clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
Councilor Holland?
Aye.
Councilor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
And Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item six tonight is petitions, requests, and communications, and we have Bruce Ness here with the Pelican Breeze Foundation. If you'd like to approach Bruce and give us a little update.
The Pelican Breeze Foundation would like to thank the City of Albert Lea for putting the new floating dock for the Pelican Breeze to use in their 2023 budget. We were asked to meet half the cost of the dock. And the Pelican Breeze Foundation contacted area businesses and people. I am happy to report through generous support, we have received contributions that make it possible to pay half of the new dock cost. We are ready for the city to order the new dock. The Pelican Breeze Foundation also appreciates the permission to place a sign on the dock recognizing the major contributors to this fundraising effort. A plan of the design was included in the packet the councilors received. Last year, the Pelican Breeze completed 25 years of operation in Albert Lea. We are pleased with the support the community has given by continuing to be our passengers. The Pelican Breeze welcomes guests to Albert Lee Lake from several states and countries. We have a very dedicated group of volunteers in our crew. In 2023, we have seen an increase in passengers on our public cruises. With a new floating dock, we hope that the boat will become even more convenient for our passengers to use this next season. Thank you.
Thank you, Bruce. And I see you have your first mate with you there.
Yes.
Did you wish to add anything, or?
Thank you.
Okay.
Well, I'll introduce her as Nancy Greiner.
All right. Thank you, Nancy.
Thank you.
Any questions from the council? Okay. Thank you very much for coming tonight and visiting with us. Appreciate
it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 7 is the unfinished business. A, ordinance amending Chapter 22, Health. This is the second reading. City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. This is the second and final reading of the ordinance amending Chapter 22, Health. The amendment is adding the enforcement mechanism prohibiting the use of cannabis in public places, namely the smoking of cannabis flower or vaping of cannabis products. Staff and Park and Recreation Board recommends approval of this final reading.
Council?
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Baker. Is there a second?
I'll second, Your Honor.
Second by Councilor Sherry Rasmussen. Any questions? Hearing none, clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
Councilor Holland?
Aye.
Councilor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
And Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item 8, new business. First item A is a resolution authorizing the Broadway Ridge Renewal Grant funding for 115 South Broadway for Gilbert J. Johnson, Jr. City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. The total improvement cost is $23,968.68, which will provide the applicant with the 50-50 match per grant policy of $11,984.34. Improvements have all been completed and reviewed by the city's zoning and building official for compliance with application requirements. Staff recommends approval.
Council?
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Baker. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Second by Councilor Christensen. Any questions or discussion?
You know, I just have one Councilor question Baker. For the city manager. I know that we kind of talked about the funding and what we have left in the Broadway Ridge Renewal Grant funding. But could you give us a updated report and send it to us at some point here in the next week or two, just so we can get an idea of how much money's in there and what where it's been spent and how that's helped the downtown?
Absolutely.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Yep.
Any other questions? Hearing none, clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Holland?
Aye.
Councilor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Item B is a resolution authorizing a Broadway Ridge renewal grant funding for 119 South Broadway, Gilbert J. Johnson, Jr. City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. The total improvement cost is $23,400, which will provide the applicant with a 50-50 match of $11,700 per our policy. All improvements have been completed and reviewed by the city zoning and building official, and staff recommends approval.
Council?
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Anderson. Is there a second?
I'll second that, Your Honor.
Second by Councilor Rob Rasmussen. Any questions, discussion? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
Councilor Holland?
Aye.
And Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item C is a resolution authorizing a Broadway Ridge renewal grant funding for 104 South Broadway, the Taco King, LLC. City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. After replacement of windows and signage, the total cost improvements is $42,352.32, of which 50-50 grant match would be $21,176.16. All improvements have been completed and reviewed by the city's zoning and building official for compliance with the requirements. Staff recommends approval.
Council?
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Baker. Is there a second?
I'll second, Your Honor.
Second by Councilor Anderson. Any questions or discussion?
Your
Councilor
Honor,
Baker.
I would just like to thank Raul and Christina for the improvements that they did to their buildings. It really, it makes it look nicer. And I know that we had some conversations over time about what might transpire down there, but it seems like everything kind of worked out. And I just want to thank them for stepping up and taking care of it.
All right. Any other discussion? Clerk, please call the roll.
Counselor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
Counselor Anderson?
Aye.
Counselor Christensen?
Aye.
Counselor Baker?
Aye.
Counselor Holland?
Aye.
Counselor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item D is a resolution awarding professional services agreement with Donahue and Associates for WWTP Facility Plan Peer Review, job number 2108.
Thank you, Your Honor. Just very simply put, this process is to essentially spend a very small amount of money to review what our engineers have put together to date for the wastewater treatment plant. This is an $80 million project. So the the total project cost of $30,000 or $30,640 is a very small cost to make sure that we are on the right path and give confidence in the process that we're moving forward with. And so with that, we recommend approval.
All right, counsel.
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Counselor Baker, is there a second?
I'll second that.
Second by Counselor Sherry Rasmussen. Any discussion? Counselor Baker.
One question I have with this is, you know, I understand why we're doing it, but say this professional, this company comes in with they discover something else, or they come in with a better plan or something like that. Would the city in turn look at maybe hiring them to do the rest of this, or is this just a way to check the other company that gave us proposals work? Is that what that's basically about?
City manager?
It's more to provide the check, but also it will give us some insight on maybe some other ideas that we can then discuss mm-hmm. with the current engineer. And while I don't ever suspect there to be a problem, there are times that engineers have different ideas of how to go about things. And sometimes you get a better product when one says, you know, maybe if you did it this way, ran it through and staged it this way, it might work better. Those are all the things that are very helpful in the process. So while I would not expect a giant a report to come back saying, oh, scrap the whole thing, it's not going to work. What I would suspect is that, you know, there could be some improvements here, there could be some slight changes here, or have you considered these ideas? And if you haven't considered them, look into them. If you have considered them, then you're able to answer why you didn't move forward with it. So it's just basically having an educated person go through and really review and critique the plan that you have to make the plan better and force you to understand it better as well.
So basically we would stick with Bolton and Mink as the main company to oversee this.
That is our expectation.
Okay.
This is not intended to overturn everything. This okay. is more intended to provide that second set of eyes that will then give us maybe some new insights, or maybe there are some minor changes, or there are certain things that we had not considered.
Okay, thank you.
Counselor Christensen.
Your Honor, thank you. I just wanted to say, I think this is very prudent to spend that money. I think with a project of this magnitude, having another set of eyes, and as you described it, you know, another way of looking at things is money well spent.
City Manager, I was wondering, is this peer review going to be something that's ongoing then through the whole project, or is this just going to be done up front and then they're done, this group?
I would say the intent is that this would be the only time that we would do that. I've not heard of it happening any further, because I think once we get through this, then we're going to start getting into the final design stages where that we will start to develop the construction drawings.
Your Honor.
I think I would like to defer to the city engineer to answer a little bit more, but that is my understanding.
City Engineer Yonke.
So one piece of this is they're looking at our facility plan, and then
saying, as the city manager said, you know, yes, this is the right process, or this is, but once, one, the last piece of this is to do a value engineering. So once Bolton and Mink does get the design together, you know, it's looking at that. Can you save $100,000 here by doing this? Can you tweak this? That is part of this as well.
Thank you. Any other questions? Hearing none, clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
Councilor Holland?
Aye.
Councilor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
And Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item E is a resolution approving the permanent right-of-way easement. City manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. Essentially, this agreement would allow me to go ahead and sign and have recorded a right-of-way easement for along Albert Lee Street, from Albert Lee Street to the shoreline. Evidence suggested that there an easement was drafted, and it was to the shoreline, given numerous other documents. However, it was either not recorded or lost at some point, so we are looking at coming up with this agreement to head off any other legal claims and to simply resolve the matter in a way that I think both sides can agree to and still ultimately achieves, I think, our primary goals, both for the property owner and our primary goals as a city. So. Oh, and staff does recommend approval.
Okay, thank you. Council.
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Christensen. Is there a second?
I'll second that, Your Honor.
Second by Councilor Anderson. Thank you. Is there any discussion or questions? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
Councilor Holland?
Aye.
Councilor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
And Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item F is a resolution authorizing action on tax forfeited properties, city requested properties. City manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. To the list that we have here, there are, and in the resolution, many of the properties are going to be demolition, or three of them are demolition diversion, where there's partial demolition and significant structural changes or structural improvements to prevent them from falling in. And then there are a few other properties that we're looking at trying to make some other necessary corrections. But if a solution presents itself between now and the time of sale that does not require city involvement, staff would have the authority within this resolution to withdraw those particular properties. If you wish, I can go through and list the properties here.
Let's get a motion on the floor, and then we'll ask the council.
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Baker. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Second by Councilor Sherry Rasmussen. All right. Would you like to hear the properties and have the city manager just go through briefly a description?
Yeah.
Yes?
Yes.
All right.
Okay. Okay. First up, we have 409 Clark Street. That would be a demolition and could potentially serve as future housing because of the size of the lot. 225 Pearl Street has some significant issues. Mainly, there's a lot of junk inside the house, as well as there's a foundation issue. We believe that given everything from the debts to the amount of work that are on this property, a private solution is very unlikely to resolve the matter. So this would be a prime candidate for demolition diversion. 122 Ermina is another one that would be a good one for demolition diversion. This is not residential property, though. This is commercial space. There are some attachments to the warehouse and an auxiliary building that needs to be demolished. It has been placarded for years, and so this will just be one way for us to be able to proceed. 821 Jefferson is a rental property that has some significant structural issues, as well as some HVAC issues that will need to be rectified in order for it to be a licensable rental property. 917 Broadway Avenue South is a property that is very hazardous and needs to be demolished. 725 Plainview Lane is a property that, again, is hazardous, needs to be demolished. 1712 Eberhardt Street, I believe, had one point caught fire. This property needs to be demolished. 502 Adams is property along that has, in the past, had railroad ties and other stuff stored on it. This particular property we'd be looking at adding to the rail trail eventually. And then property identified as 34.403.0010 and .0020 are two adjoined properties that there are some right-of-way and easement issues that need to be resolved. But if they can be resolved prior to the sale, staff would then withdraw those particular properties. Any further questions, comments, concerns?
Well, I do have one question on the properties that are deemed to be have to be demolished. Do we have a timeline on that, when that's going to happen, or is that just?
We'd probably be looking over the winter of 24. So by the time we actually got the properties in our name, went through, we're able to go through and test for asbestos, which we can do internally, or at least we can pull the material to then ship it out to have it tested. So we'd be able to do that. And then from that, we would then determine how we're going to bid it out. And so I'd say we'd probably be bidding it out as early as December, probably no later than February of the following year. And then we'd be looking at demolition over the winter and filling, grading, resodding, or putting new grass down over the spring of 24.
Bidding it in the winter might be to the advantage, the city's advantage, because you might get a cheaper price, being that that's kind of off. It's kind of off season for a lot of contractors.
That would be our thought and our hope as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
Councilor Holland?
Aye.
Councilor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
And Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item G is a resolution authorizing action on tax forfeited properties, cancel or reduce assessment. City Manager?
Thank you. Staff recommends changes to the assessment balance so the county may increase the saleability of the properties at tax forfeiture sale in September.
Council, are you recommending approval of that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, we do.
Thank you. Council?
I'll move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Sherry Rasmussen. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Second by Councilor Anderson. Thank you. Any discussion, questions? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Holland?
Aye.
Councilor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
And Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item H is a resolution approving the publication summary of Ordinance 23-100, amending Chapter 22, Health. City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. In order to publish a summary instead of the full ordinance, Council needs to pass a resolution authorizing said summary. And staff recommends approval.
All right. Council?
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Baker. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Second by Councilor Christensen. Any questions or discussion? Hearing none, clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
Councilor Holland?
Aye.
And Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item I is a resolution ordering improvement and preparation of plans for property stabilization at 137 Clark Street East. City Manager?
Thank you, Your Honor. Back in June, staff started to notice that bricks were falling from the building at 137 in the back end. So as a matter of public safety, we got an engineer in there, contacted the owners, and managed to work out a voluntary assessment agreement as we were looking at emergency shoring in order to, one, preserve the building, but most importantly, to preserve the health and safety of the public, given that there was a good chance if it fell, it'd fall into the right-of-way or on adjacent buildings that are inhabited. Or, excuse me, that are habited. And we were very concerned about that, so we did have to take more immediate action. I think to date we spent about $10,000 on engineering and about $87,000 on shoring. And with this resolution, we're asking for about another $250,000 to finish the stabilization of the building. All these costs will be assessed to the building, and the property owner will have to reimburse it. And it's not only assessed to this particular building and property, but all the properties that those particular owners have within inside the city limits of Albert Lea. And staff does recommend approval.
Council?
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Baker. Is there a second?
I'll second that, Your Honor.
Second by Councilor Rob Rasmussen. Discussion?
I do have a question for the city manager. Does the prior owners, have they been informed of what's happening here? Do they know?
They are aware. They did sign the voluntary assessment, which does have these particular action items and the costs in the agreement.
What's their response to this?
I have not been dealing with them directly. Our building and zoning official has been. Essentially, my understanding is that they are working on solutions. They are just not coming about very quickly.
Okay. If you could talk to the building inspector to find out if there's more to this whole thing, would be appreciative. And if so, let us know.
All right.
Because this has been kind of a long time. It's been a long time since they bought the place, and the plans that they were going to move forward with for some housing, some apartments and stuff, and it just seems to come to a screeching halt. And I think somehow, some way, we as a city, we need to do something to move something forward over there. I think that's the least the citizens of this community deserve.
City manager?
I do not disagree. It is in private ownership. They can reveal what they want to us about where they're at and where things are going. All we can do is from a public safety and just a long-term preservation aspect is look at what can we do to keep the building from falling in and creating a hazard or creating more expense for us later down the road if it were to be potentially ever abandoned. The damage to the building has been a long time coming. It has been neglect, I would say, over the period of multiple owners, you know, two if not more. So this definitely did not happen overnight, and it was largely caused by the roof, damage to the roof. So, and this is essentially to preserve the building. This is what we're faced with, but we will be assessing it. It's not intended to be a free ride for the property owners by any means.
So,
Mr. Baker,
I was just going to say another thing was brought up, that part of this restoration part or to fortify it is going to be tuck pointing. But to me, looking at that wall, looks like that back wall, part of it, a good part of it, needs to be rebuilt.
City manager?
It's a combination of some parts of it will need to be rebuilt. Some of it will need to be tuck pointed. Basically, it'll have to be feathered in one way. We've looked at a couple of different options, everything from the entire back wall being removed, rebuilt, and then tied into the existing walls and that being tuck pointed and strengthened. There are a number of different options that have been looked at, and I have not gone over the architectural plans that were just given to us, I believe, Friday. So we'll have more to go over on that. But essentially, first things first is the roof does need to be taken care of. The walls are shored up, so it is safe. But and we bought ourselves time to get a contractor in there to do the work, or even the private or the owner, dependent upon when certain things become available. Because if private owner is able to step in and finish it up, then we will gladly withdraw ourselves from that.
Do you have any type of timeline on this that you would like to accomplish?
Well, I would love to have it done sooner than later, but I think that with everything that need to be done, we're probably not going to be, some of the work cannot be done until the spring because of the cold weather that's coming up, so.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Any other discussion? Councilor Anderson.
My understanding is that it's also not just a public safety issue, but it's also damage to the adjoining properties, the neighboring properties that we're trying to prevent. And it seems like we're throwing a lot of money down a hole, but we almost have to. Is that kind of what we're saying?
If the back wall were to fall and damage one of the other buildings, the cleanup costs of what we'd have to take down, and then also the potential damages to the other building, especially if it was not insured, we'd probably be looking at a combination of those particular private owners and the damage that was done to their building, as well as the city coming in and cleaning up the mess. We'd probably be looking at about the same amount as what we're dealing with right now. But what we'd have is we'd have one less historic building that is truly unique and if done right, could really provide one, more housing, but two, just preservation of a really, truly unique building. I don't know if you stop and look at that stained glass, and it is truly, it truly provides some unique identity to the community. But I think all in all, inaction will not have the upfront cost, but long term will have more costs for the city at this point.
All right. Anyone else? Councilor Howland.
I'd just like to thank city officials, building officials for being on top of this. If folks in the public don't think that this type of stuff is important, that it is, when we talk about public safety and hazards and stuff, think of the tragedy that happened in Davenport, Iowa earlier this summer with a building collapsing. Obviously that was a much larger building and people lived there, but we have to stay on top of these things. So thanks to city staff for keeping on top of it and making sure that these things don't get worse than they already are.
Okay. Any other discussion? I'd like to ask the city manager, on the other three properties that these investors have tied to them, what is the valuation of those properties? Are they in the same shape this building is in, or is it a valuable asset?
I believe two of them were already intended to be demoed, and they are not. I believe they're in the district, but I do not believe they are contributing buildings. And then the other one is directly adjoined to this building, and as far as we know, that building is not in nearly the condition that the main one that we're looking at is.
So the other assets that are backing this up aren't really much of assets, then.
No, they're not. But at the same point, it would allow that if we were ever in a situation, hypothetically, where the city took ownership due to them failing to pay the assessments, we would be in a much better position to reclaim more of that as all four of them together, as originally planned and proposed when the developers were looking at this. Then it would be just that particular one separate and still connected to another parcel that would be in different ownership. So I think in part the reason why we tied to it is because the original intent of this person had when they got the building was to take those four properties and make something of it altogether. And so that way it also gives us that same opportunity with the assessment. If they fail to come through.
I don't know if the city manager can answer this question or if this is something that we need to take to our inspection department, but does it seem like more and more properties are coming in front of us, either as the list of foreclosures that we did tonight, the buildings on Broadway that we're having to work with? It just seems to me that we're getting more and more of these. So is there a need to dive into what we're doing on real estate in this community a little deeper to just try to preempt some of this, and because it seems like we're expanding a lot of tax dollars on taking care of buildings that should have never got in the shape that they're in had the original owners or successor owners, or in this case, multiple successor owners, taking care of their property. So how do we go about changing this so that we don't continue to have 10 more properties that were in foreclosure, another huge historic building downtown that's falling apart? I mean, it just seems like it's a never-ending story, and something needs to be done on a more grand scale to try to end this. City manager.
Staff have lots of ideas. We have been putting more effort and focus in preemptive efforts. For instance, the three grants that we just did, and sharing some of those costs. If we had waited 10, 20 years, like what happened with this building, we'd be faced with something far greater. So continuing to find workers, you know, or continuing to find property owners that are willing to work with us, like the owners of the Taco King and I believe Mr. Johnson with the other two properties. These are the preemptive measures that we are looking at, and the reason why we put such emphasis on things like roofs, windows, and tuck pointing is because that is just so important to the preservation of these buildings. But some of what we're doing now, if we had staff focusing on that 10, 20 years ago, we might not be facing some of these same issues, but there's always going to be that upfront of cleaning up the past and then working on the preemption for the future. I think also our involvement in the tax foreclosures, essentially what we're doing is we're getting an inspection before the roof caves in or the wall caves in or the back end of a house slumps into the basement. So in part, when we're looking at this list here right now, again, this is that 80 to 200 houses that we think that, you know, probably need significant work or demolition. This is us getting ahead on a number of those properties as well, as opposed to in the past where it was just a matter of it went up for tax sale and whoever wrote a song for it, you know, got it real cheap and, you know, that's and then didn't do anything with it, and then eventually it goes through that cycle. And so we're trying to interrupt that cycle. So these are some of the preemptions that we're trying to do. And unfortunately, this round, there were way too many that were just too far gone that we were not able to do that. I think it's almost 2 to 1 that we know we had to demolish that we can't save on the tax forfeiture. But but last year, I think we had a much better success. I think it was 3 to 1 we saved as opposed to demolish. So we are doing what we can to be preemptive of it. Yeah,
this just didn't happen in the last couple of years. These buildings that are going down right now happened over the last 10, 20, 30 years. I mean, how long has the VFW over here been empty? 20 years? Probably. It's been a long-term process. So somehow we have to keep, and I know we've started some programs to try to get a handle on these, do some of the demo on some that we have to, but demo diversion on some that we can save. But when you get into costs like we have in the VFW here, I mean, that's a huge cost of $350,000. We got to figure out a way to somehow get in front of that. So,
and 10 years ago, if we'd put $20,000 in it as a match on the roof, we probably wouldn't be looking at this right now.
All right. Something for us all to think about going forward. Councilor Christensen.
Your Honor, I want to thank you for your comments and also you, City Manager, because I think this has been bothering me a lot also. It seems like there is so much. But I would like to recommend that perhaps sometime we could have a special, not a workshop before a meeting, because that would not be enough time, but a special session to look at this, both for commercial and residential properties, how we can get a handle on approaching this. Because I drove around and I looked at all of these properties that were on our list, and there's a lot of properties that could have been on the list that weren't. We've got a lot of work to do. Thank you.
Yes, we do. Thank you. Anything else? Clerk, please call the roll.
Counselor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
Counselor Anderson?
Aye.
Counselor Christensen?
Aye.
Counselor Baker?
Aye.
Counselor Holland?
Aye.
Counselor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Aye, motion carries. Item nine is mayor and council reports, and tonight we're going to start with Counselor Rob Rasmussen, Ward 5.
Yes, Your Honor. I have one old ward item JD helped me with on a property. Then I had a library board meeting on the 16th. Some of the things we went over is the summer programs for adults and kids were a huge success. They had a second annual local author event held on the 22nd. Seven authors attended. That was a success with attendees. The library plans to install a self-service printing station this fall. The library will be doing looking into new strategic planning process in 2024 to take effect in 2025. They will look to see if an outside consultant is feasible to complete the process. If not, they will look to Selco. Outreach events are helping to include different populations in the community for outreach. Let them know what the services that the Albert Lee Public Library provides. And then the library director has looked at other organizations to possibly see that they'd be able to work with to help in any of their programming or operations that they got going on. Two library assistants will be attending a one-day event of the Minnesota Library Association Conference this fall to encourage professional development among staff. And they want, the library wants to try to work with the county commissioners more to see if the what they can do together is set goals. And circulation is increased by 14%. After we eliminated the youth fees, and I think they are also looking at that. Then we talked about for the adult late fees as well. And then that's it, Your Honor.
All right, thank you. Ward 6, Counselor Anderson.
Your Honor, I didn't have any ward items. I did have an HRA meeting. I don't want to steal Counselor Baker's thunder about this, but Dr. Mitchell was at the meeting, the new HRA director. It's kind of exciting. She's taken over. There's, you know, some a little understaffed right now, but they still got a great group of people to build her organization around. So she's going to get to pick a couple of key people, and we're excited going forward. I also, my understanding is that some of these things we're talking about that the city does with the Broadway Ridge Renewal Grant, the HRA can do with homeowners as well, do like the 50-50 matches and things like that if there are programs and grants available. So maybe that could mitigate some of these long lists from developing out there at least once in a while. Something to look forward to anyways, Your Honor.
Thank you. Ward 1, Counselor Christensen.
Thank you. Well, along with a number of the others from the council and the city, and I attended the fundraiser for the all-inclusive park, and it was a fantastic day. so happy for that group to see such success and excitement by the public in supporting that endeavor. This Wednesday, a new series is going to be starting on Netflix for anyone who has it. It is Live to 100, Secrets of the Blue Zones, put on by Dan Buettner. So if any of you have Netflix and are interested, it I'm sure will be an excellent series. Budget committees are, the budget committee is working on the budget. We've got a lot of work to do there. Planning and zoning is meeting next Tuesday. Keeping busy with all sorts of things. And I was just going to add that there seem to be a lot of festivals going on. So this coming Saturday, we've got the Daisy Fest at Central Park, and I'm excited that I get to be a part of it. So anybody who's interested, it's kind of a health and wellness fest. Please show up. Central Park, 10 to 4.
All right, thank you. Ward 2, Councilor Baker.
Thank you, Your Honor. I do have one ward item that I will get in contact with the city manager to see if we can get that resolved. As Councilor Anderson said, we did have an HRA meeting, and with the new executive director, that we took one step forward. Unfortunately, we had a very good employee. She was acting as the interim director. She decided that she wanted to go elsewhere, so she left and she found another job, and which is unfortunate because she did really good. She did a real good job, but I think that this is just going to have to play out, and I appreciate, I talked to the city manager about this whole thing, and they have, I know finance has reached out to them, and so I do appreciate any help that the city can give them would be more than welcome, and I know she's looking forward to meeting with you too, so the new director, so maybe you could reach out to her, or maybe she's reached out to you already, and get something planned so you guys can get together and get something rolling here. Okay, thank you, Your Honor.
All right, thank you. Ward 3, Councilor Howland.
Thank you, Your Honor. So I also attended the Lead Inclusion Fly Kite Festival out at Edgewater Park. It was a fantastic day. I also participated, as I know you did, Mr. Mayor, in the dunk tank, so hopefully we raise some good money as people wanted to take some shots at us. But yeah, it was a lot of fun and a great event. And from what I read in the paper, they raised over $27,000. So fantastic for the inclusive playground and Miracle Field. I was not able to attend the Park and Rec board meeting, but I did get the minutes. So I can just pass along a few things that were discussed. They went over the Apex proposal for the recreation facilities, the City Arena Aquatic Center, and the Marion Ross Performing Arts Center, and the Park and Rec Board voted to recommend that City Council pursue all of these projects that are on their capital improvement projects. They also, as I think the city manager mentioned in our work session maybe, they recommended the second reading that we had, they recommended that the council pass prohibiting cannabis smoking in public parks and facilities as well. And then just a quick stat for you, the pool closed on August 13th, and this year there were 17,861 people that came to the Aquatic Center, and they had 180 memberships sold, and 332 people had swim lessons at the Aquatic Center. So almost 18,000 people took a dip in the city pool this year. So fantastic. That's it, Your Honor.
Thank you. Ward 6, Councilor Sherry Rasmussen.
Thank you, Your Honor. And I'm Ward 4.
Four, I'm sorry. You're the last person tonight, son.
No, I know. So things have been going well in Ward 4. I just want to continue to encourage people. If you are noticing things with people not taking care of their lawns or rubbish or old vehicles or boats in their yards, things like that, don't be afraid to call the non-emergency number, the 507-377-5780. That seems to be the biggest thing that I get calls on. And it's important when those things happen that we have a record that they're happening. So don't be afraid to call the number, and you can call anonymously if you'd like to, but just know that our community resource officer is there for us to help us with those things. I also want to mention with the Senior Center, the Senior Center is having a big event on September 27th. They're taking a trip to Mystic Lake Casino. So again, that's going to be September 27th. You have to sign up with the Senior Center, $30 for members, $35 for non-members. They're going to bus you up there, have a day of fun. You get $15 of cash to play with, $4 food coupon, and they're going to leave at 8:30 in the morning on September 27th. So if you're interested in that, get a hold of the Senior Center and sign up for that. I think it'll be a really fun thing. And I want to talk about the all-inclusive playground and the event this weekend. I had the opportunity to work at the gate, and I was blown away by the generosity of our community. I had people give me a dollar. I had people give me $500. It was absolutely amazing. And I was really shocked at how many people, after they went, when they were coming back out, they were so excited and said how much fun they had and how much they loved it and how excited they were for this to be in our community. So to everybody that's been involved with this project, I mean, it's just really, really wonderful. And people were coming from different communities. I saw a lot of people come up from Iowa. So it was really great to see us all pull together as a community and do this. And I don't know, I'm proud of us as a community for this because it was really a beautiful thing. So thank you.
All right, thank you. I will add also, it was a fun event. The only thing, as I'm listening to everybody talk about it, Councillor Howland, don't you think that Councillor Christensen and Councillor Rasmussen should have been in the dunk tank? Mm-hmm.
It's only
it
fair.
Would have only been fair.
I think Baker would have.
Yeah.
He probably would have made the most money.
Yeah. Well, it was a great time had by all. And for those of you that didn't get out there, get out online and look at it. It was just very, watching all the kites flying out there. The kids were having a great time, and the adults were having just as good a time. So that was a lot of fun. I'm glad that they were able to raise a lot of money to go towards the Inclusive Park. Also attended the business after hours with Councillor Christensen last week, Tuesday. First one for fall here, and there'll be another one coming up, I believe, September 19th, I believe, whatever that Tuesday is right there. And then Councillor Christensen mentioned the Netflix. I'll just point out that we were in the Star Tribune yesterday in the Sunday paper. Albert Lea Revisited in Netflix Live to 100. Albert Lea, Minnesota, I'll just do a first paragraph, gets only a few minutes of screen time in Live to 100, Secrets of the Blue Zone. But it's hard to imagine that the docuseries would exist or that its host, Dan Buettner, would have become such a guru of longevity without the city agreeing to be ground zero for this bold experiment. What a nice little kudos to Albert Lea for that. So that was very nice. So that's out in the Star Tribune if anybody wanted to go out and see it. Other things coming up here, we have Thursdays on Fountain. Last event is this Thursday, August 31st. There will be food trucks in North Broadway and music, of course, the Tony Cuccetti Band from 5:30 to 7. And so get out and enjoy the music, last one of the year. Councillor Christensen mentioned Daisy Fest. That's this coming Saturday from 10 to 4 at Central Park. And then Taste of Albert Lea will be on Saturday, September 9th from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. at Central Park. There will be food trucks and beverages, live music, play cornhole with your friends, or just come to eat. Taste of Albert Lea brings all sorts of favorite food vendors together in one place for you to enjoy. And then just a reminder, city offices will be closed on Monday, September 4th. And I think that's all I have tonight. So with that, let's go ahead to item 10, the city manager report.
Thank you, Your Honor. I attended the Chamber of Commerce's leadership program, basically their kickoff. I'm one of the day presenters, but I attended to meet with a number of the members a little more, just introduce myself and get to know them a little bit. And what I can say is that I really think that this is a very unique, very good program that really, when you bring people into it that are new to the community or have not fully experienced the community, it's a very good program for people to get to know each other, get to know more about the community, what's going on. When we're going through a list of all the different things that are available to community, activities, retail, business opportunities, et cetera, a number of people, you know, I think individually when they sit down, they kind of, you know, go a little fuzzy, draw a little bit of blank. But when you start talking about it as a group and, oh, yeah, and then there's this and there's that, and a lot of people just as they're sitting together, hearing from other people or learning brand new things about the community that they did not know and may never have known. So it's a very good and worthwhile program. And while signing up for this year's is closed, I would just keep in mind that people should look for it next year. And if you have any questions, just contact Sherry at the Chamber. Staff and I are continuing to work on the budget and capital improvement plan has been submitted. I believe the last of it's been submitted. We have spent some time going over, as staff, going over the healthcare plan. There's definitely been, I think, hopefully some positive movement there. Been attending meetings with Alita and going over some other, again, continue to go over potential development ideas. I really look forward to meeting with the new director of the HRA. I think there's just so many great things that we will be able to do together. I'm very excited and happy about the new director coming on board. I am sad to see some of the support staff leave, and I know that city staff have stepped up where they can to try and help out. And again, that just goes to the strength of us trying to, or our continued attempts at increasing our bonds and strengthening cooperation. And another thing that's been taking a great deal of time has been cannabis. Continue to work on that. How do we deal with it? How do we zone it? Staff having discussions about that, about what's our path moving forward. There's a number of implications that we continue to work through and try to get done. But we're going to have a lot of discussions in the future about that. So luckily, I know an intern or a former intern of mine is actually a college professor in one of the courses I heard he's teaching. Now deals with impacts of legalized marijuana, so I'm going to go and pick his brain as well a little bit. So, yeah, that's been my last couple of weeks, and probably my next couple of weeks.
Thank you. Item 11 is approval of claims. Item A, a resolution approving claims. Number one is a presentation of claims over $25,000. City Manager.
Thank you, Your Honor. $25,200.93 to Freeborn Meyer Electric Cooperative Service. This is for electric services at sanitary lift stations, storm lift stations, and water plants. $32,234.85 to Bolton Mink. This is for the wastewater treatment facility improvement project. $33,858.05 to Rainbow Tree Company. This is final emerald ash borer treatments. $46,836.31 to Freeborn Meyer Electric Cooperative Services. This is for electricity at the wastewater treatment plant. $56,894.99 to Minnesota Public Facilities Authority. This is a loan payment and interest. This is loan payment, interest, and principal.
Council?
Move to approve, Your Honor.
Motion by Councilor Baker. Is there a second?
Second, Your
Second
Honor.
By Councilor Christensen. Any questions? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
Councilor Holland?
Aye.
Councilor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
And Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. Item 12 is a closed session subject to Minnesota Statute 13D3. We will be discussing union negotiations.
Correct.
Is there a motion to go into closed session?
So moved.
Motion by Councilor Anderson. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Second by Councilor Sherry Rasmussen. Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor Christensen?
Aye.
Councilor Baker?
Aye.
Councilor Holland?
Aye.
Councilor Sherry Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Robert Rasmussen?
Aye.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
And Mayor Murray?
Aye. Motion carries. We are now moving into closed session. If we could have everybody please vacate this room.